water might be soft, but public bowl equipment is
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. We're going to throw it up online in PDF.
If you say so. All right, let's rock and roll.
All right, good morning, everyone. We are down a computer, likely because of the power outage last week. So we'll have one screen, which should make it easier to just focus on one. As always, we're at KCStat this morning on the topic of neighborhoods and healthy communities. We'll be walking through the citywide business plan goals and objective strategies related to that goal. We'll also be doing some live tweeting, so you can follow along using the hashtag KCStat. Any questions, comments can be tweeted at us using that hashtag even after the session is over if you're seeing it on an archive video. We will try to respond in due time. So with that, we'll kind of roll through. Oh, Kate is getting the deck up, put up online right now. So I will try to improv while she does that. It was a lovely morning, a little freezing rain. That was nice, boss. Did you? All right. All right, ready to roll. So within this section, we've got a lot of ground to cover. I think there's about 115 slides, so I'm going to push you a little through this deck. But we will start a little bit out of order, but in an order that sort of makes sense for the panel, with objective 2, bolster community development, cultural activities, and resident engagement. First strategy under there is related to community centers and programming from our Parks and Recreation Department. And welcome to our new Director of Parks and Recreation, Terry Reiner, and her staff.
And our new Deputy Director, Roosevelt Lyons.
That is true also. Good morning.
Good morning. All right, so strategy A, let you read it there, implement services and programs and activities. So last time I was here, we talked a lot about customer service. Back in March of last year, we kicked off our year with my staff. We do a retreat every year. We talked a lot about customer service. And we said one of our focuses for the whole year was going to be customer service. So we kicked off a customer service initiative. One of the reasons we decided, the main reason we decided to focus on customer service is because at the end of the day, what matters, what brings people back, is their customer experience. You can have the best programs, you can have the best facilities, you can have all of those things, but if you don't have a great customer experience, then people just aren't going to come back. So we started to focus on customer service. When I came here last fall, we had just finished up our initial round of Secret Shopper. So we do a Secret Shopper program. We did a blind benchmark back in July, and I shared some of that data with you. And the blind benchmark just had, we did at all of our community centers, including Lakeside Nature Center, 4 in-person shops and 4 over-the-phone shops. We got all that data, crunched it, and we did an they gave us an executive summary. And so that's where we were then. And one of the things we knew right then was that one of the findings from there was we had this inconsistent quality of customer service. Sometimes it was really good, and sometimes it was really not that great. So we wanted to focus on adding that consistency and quality across the board. So you'll see on this first slide there, on that first round of Secret Shopping, our overall score was 76.6. Not a great score, not something we were really proud of at that time. Again, what we saw were some centers were doing really well, scoring in the low 90s to the low 80s, and then some below 70%, which was unacceptable. So we just finished up our second round of shopping here in November and December. This time we did 6 total shops, so 3 phones, 3 visits. The overall score increased to 84.8%, which is, our goal was to get to 82% this round, so we actually exceeded that, so I was really happy to see that. There you can see the difference between our on-site and our telephone inquiries. Our on-site, which we focused a lot of our training on and discussion on with my supervisors, on improving our on-site score. This is when people come to visit us. So from there you can see it increased about 12 points, so from 75% to about 87%. And then our phone scores also went up. They were at 78% and they increased to 81%.
So the benchmark in that is us, is our
standard. Yes, that's our benchmark there. Yes, that's our baseline.
So 17 or whatever that was.
That was July of 18. So that was all of our staff, and they didn't know we were doing Secret Shopping at that time. So again, they call it a blind benchmark, and only our management staff knew we were doing that at the time. So, yeah. So this next slide digs a little deeper into that actual survey. What we really focus on is team member performance. The survey is actually broken up into several different parts, including the facility, management accountability. But the part we really wanted to focus on is the team member performance. So this is the individual interactions. And that's made up of four parts: attitude and respect, professionalism, salesmanship, and knowledge. So as you can see, we had a lot of increases across the board here. So and again, on site, we did a lot better. You can see that we increased our attitude and respect. This is how we come across to those people when they come in the door. And I would say one of the main drivers of whether you come back to a place or not, by 14% on site and 7% on the phone. Our professionalism, so this is whether people were wearing name tags, uniforms, whether they were ready for customers when they were walked in the door. On-site, that went up 20%, which is awesome. And then over the phone, went up 7%. Our salesmanship is our lowest score of these four scores, so it's something we really struggle with. One of the things that came across regularly during that benchmark was our staff is really good about sharing the information, but that's it. They don't take that extra step to kind of talk through and say, hey, can I sign you up today? Let me tell you about these great services we have. They just kind of share the information. So last time our on-site was at a 54%, so that's very low and unacceptable. This time our on-site jumped to 78%, and our on-the-phone was static at 66%, which still needs some improvement there. Our knowledge also went up. We had a fairly high score in knowledge already, so our staff knows what they're talking about. It's just the delivery of that we need to really work on. But you can see that our telephone scores dipped a little bit. And the reason actually for that, one of my managers pointed out, was this was one of the first times we actually didn't print up a fall winter guide. We normally print these up and have these on hand for our staff. This is one of the first times we didn't do that. And this is one of the main sources of information when people are calling in. So they didn't have that on hand. So we could see those scores dipped a little bit. So we've learned that lesson. Always print those up and have those on hand for our staff no matter what. So the next slide digs a little deeper into attitude and respect. And you can see how it's broken out here over several categories. One of the easiest ones is greeting. We put a lot of work into our greetings, making sure that we had a standard greeting.
I thought you said breeding for a while.
That's a whole different kind of customer service. Yeah. So the greeting, we standardize our greeting. A lot of centers were doing things differently, so we all have a standard greeting. We wrote up a script. We kept those at our desk so that everybody had the same greeting. So you can see how that Q4 jumped up 21%, which is awesome. You can see big increases in tone, expression, and posture. We really had to drive home telling our staff that, you know, regardless of how you feel that day when you come into work, regardless of what happened at home that day, you got the kids late on the bus and all that, once you walk in the door, you have to put your game face on and get started. Another good one is appreciation. So people felt more appreciated this time around. The one thing that went down a little bit was rapport. Again, this is something our staff struggles with a little bit, and that is, and we say rapport is actually asking a question that's not related to the actual transaction, right? So how's the weather? How about those Chiefs? All those kind of things that, where do you live, that are just, that show you're interested in your guests and just goes a little extra mile. So overall, a 14% increase, and we're pretty happy about that. Still some work to do, though. Professionalism, again. Name tags, these are a lot of the easy ones. So name tags, we weren't being consistent about wearing name tags. And these are really the things that our site supervisors need to be monitoring, making sure our staff wears name tags. As you can see, we're very well groomed. I'd say we're the best looking recreation division out there. That's just my opinion.
Best one in Kansas City. Yeah.
Thank you. Our staff is engaged, so that I was happy to see that score go up to 100%. So 100% of the secret shoppers that came in there felt like our staff was engaged with them. So that was really good to see. And also the memorable score went up 25%. So would you say your visit was memorable? So that increased as well. So we're at 83% for total professionalism, which is good. Again, this is one that's a lot of easy wins here that I would expect to see at 90-95% going forward. And then we have salesmanship. Again, we had a lot of growth in our salesmanship scores, overall 27%, but still we have a long way to go here. As you can see, with a total score of 78%, that's up from 54%, which is pretty low already. But needs assessment, again, just asking those customers what it is they need. How old are your kids? How often do you work out? What do you like? Just a little more engagement on that. So 26% increase there. And walkthroughs, this is an easy one that I would hope was 100%. I understand that things happen sometimes when people are walking in the door, but getting up, making sure that you give new customers a walkthrough of the facility, show them where everything is so they get comfortable with it. So it's up to 79%. Again, that should be 85, 90% of the time. And then closing is something we struggle with, just closing that deal. Hey, these spots are filling up. Can I get you signed up today? Just making a pitch to try to close that deal out. So lot of improvement there. We still got some ways to go at 65%, though. And I should say, we have our April 8th is going to be our next retreat. So the focus of that retreat will be salesmanship. So we'll do some training on salesmanship, some facilitated discussion on salesmanship on how to do that a little bit better. So, and now we have our NPS rating. So an NPS rating can go from a negative 100 to a positive 100. And the way you get that score is you take your promoters, which are your the people that score you as a 9 or a 10 out of 10, and you subtract your detractors, which are those that are...
Well, wait a minute. What's NPS?
NPS, Net Promoter Score. I'm sorry.
Right. And what's that? What does that mean?
So it's a common benchmark that gets used a lot to talk about how well your customers are going to go out there and talk about your business in a positive way, right? So like I said, it could be as low as negative 100. It could be as high as positive 100. And you get that score by taking your promoters, which are the total of your nines and your tens, minus your detractors, which are your zeros through sixes. Your sevens and eights are just the middle of the ground. They're not going to talk you up. They're not going to talk you down. They're just kind of there. So the first time around, we were at 29, which is a decent net promoter score. It's not the best, but it's a decent one. This time around, we're at 42. So we had a lot more promoters and a lot fewer detractors this time around. And just for some context, I always say our goal is to be the Chick-fil-A of Parks and Recreation. If you've been to Chick-fil-A, I've never had a bad experience with Chick-fil-A. That net promoter score is 58. So we have a little ways to go, but we actually made a lot of ground on them. Apple is considered to be the benchmark, and I think they're at 89 is their net promoter score. So and that's the highest net promoter score out there. So 42 is a good score. Again, I like to, we're chasing Chick-fil-A is what I'd like to see.
And Rosa, what are your detractors? What are the comments that the detractors are saying?
So it's the same thing for the detractors and the promoters. It's the same thing. It's customer service. So when they walked in the door, either if they had a really poor customer service experience, so when we see those scores that are less than 70%, which did happen this time around.
This is just on customer service. It doesn't take into effect facility condition or anything.
It does, actually. So there are some questions on there, usually four things that they say. It could either be customer service, the value of whatever it is that we're selling, and oftentimes our value is ranked really high. I'm trying to remember what else. There's four things, but usually it's customer service. Even when you say, hey, the value is great, if the customer service wasn't exceptional, people tend to look at that as a detraction, right?
Okay.
All right, so these are some of the steps we took during this throughout this year to help improve our customer service experience.
Glad I could help.
So as soon as we got...
You're all getting raises.
Yeah.
He's only got like 176 days left. but I'll be remaining behind to keep the ship running. I want to thank you for your service.
So these are some of the steps we took for to help improve our customer service. So as soon as we finished that initial round, that benchmark round, we had an executive summary that the company, which is called About Face, put together for us. So we went through that. I scheduled meetings every other week with my supervisors, and we sat down for about an hour and a half every morning and just talked through each one of these action steps and came up with an action plan for on-site visits and all those kind of things. Consistency, we added some consistency. So again, the greeting, standard greeting, when people are visiting and when they're on the phone. 70%. At that time, our current level is 70% is acceptable. Anything below 70%, if you score anything below 70% on that team member section, we do have some coaching and possible disciplinary action for you. And we also reward those who score over 100% or who score 100% on those as well. We had Mark, Mid-American Regional Council, come and facilitate some training for all of our staff. And this is really centered around getting a basic, consistent understanding of what quality customer service is. We found that everybody had a different expectation when it came to quality customer service. So we wanted to get everybody on the same page with that. So Mid-American Regional Council came and did some training for our staff, which went really well. We're currently in our third round of shops. So we started our third round here in January and in February. So we'll have some more data from this third round coming up. We'll have our retreat again on April 8th, where we talk more about salesmanship. So we expect those scores to go up on our final and our fourth and final round of secret shops. And then we plan on building a regular refresher into our training for our staff, so that every year we remember that we talk about customer service. Our incoming new staff get the basic customer service training. We've created an onboarding packet for our new staff currently, so that as soon as you walk in the door, the first thing you hear is about is customer service, and then you're getting a regular refresher yearly. So incentives and disciplinary actions. So we kind of take a carrot and stick approach to how we reward and discourage, reward good customer service and discourage poor customer service. So we set a goal this time around of 82% across the board of satisfactory scores. Again, we exceeded that at 84%, so we're really happy with that. We use the Spot Award program to reward our staff. So the center that gets the highest score, the center director actually gets $100. It's Garrison Community Center both times. So Brian's actually gotten two bonuses of $100. And then we give those individual staff members $50 rewards or bonuses if they score 100% on the team member section. So we think it's important. And then we do a lunch for our center, the center also. So we think it's important to reward the supervisor, the individual, and then also recognize the staff at the center as a whole. So to date, we've given away $1,700 in bonuses, which is a fairly small amount, but has a pretty big impact. We also, on the facility section, we reward our building maintenance staff. So when they score 95% or better, we also give them a bonus. Those who failed to meet actually have gotten documented counseling, and in some place disciplinary action. So we feel like that's important. We lay that out clearly. We say, hey, anything below 70% is unacceptable, so that everybody knows what the goal is here. We're also adding all these scores into all the positions on the recreation side have job expectations. We're currently adding these scores into those job expectations. So with our supervisors first, so they all have a expectation that they get a 70% minimum on the aggregate of their facility scores. So that's spelled in writing. So if they get something below that, then we take steps. It's on their annual evaluation and things like that. And then we have a policy right now. So we've drafted a progressive disciplinary action policy that says if you get on your first occurrence of getting a negative customer interaction, and that could be measured either through a 311 complaint, that could be measured with a customer coming and telling a supervisor, that could be measured through a secret shop. And once we verify that, then that's the first strike, then you have another strike, and then another strike. So it's a disciplinary action policy, which we find works really well. So people know exactly what to expect and what happens when you fail to meet those expectations. It also gives us, again, a way to reward those who that do a great job. So we try to spell that out and make sure everybody's really clear on that. So we have that drafted currently. And then we have our Happy or Not kiosk, which is just another way to get customer feedback. So these are on-site, and they have four buttons, a green happy face and a red sad face. And these are really good for collecting on-site your regular customer feedback, which is a little different than the secret shops, which is this kind of blind, I just walked in the door, haven't experienced your facility before. These are our everyday customers. Again, we've collected about 15,000 responses. Overall, since we started this, we've got about 85% satisfaction. Again, I like to see that at 90%. These scores can fluctuate day to day. If your facility is dirty that day, if you have a water main break and you have the shutoffs, anything can affect these. So we see that a lot. Top three performers, Lakeside, Westport, and Lime Creek. Our bottom three that need some work are Garrison, Tony, and Southeast. Our bottom three are also, you see, the lower scores tend to see that a lot with facilities that have a lot of youth who attend those. Sometimes they like to mess with the thing. They're our pickiest customers. It does filter
kids
out.
Kids would never do that, would they, Roosevelt? Definitely not my kid.
It does tend to filter out any, like, people that kind of play on it. So if you go over there and start hitting the button a bunch, it'll filter those out for us. And then it also shows us our pain points. So late mornings to early afternoons, that 10 o'clock to about 1 o'clock are kind of when we see our scores tend to dip, which is kind of ironic because that's when we have the most staff on hand. It's kind of our changeover time. So it does make sense we end up having more staff on hand. It's when we have the fewest amount of customers. So it looks like our customer service just lags a little bit around that time. So
that's good data, Roosevelt.
It is. Thank you.
It's good that you're tracking everything.
Again, these are action steps. So we've trained. All the centers have action plans for improving their customer service. Again, we set that immediate goal of 82% satisfaction with a long-term goal of 90% by the end of the fiscal year. That's where we are, and we're in progress on that one right now. The bottom line is, what's the payoff here? So a lot of people will say that, all right, you've done all this customer service. We spent money on this. This is about $15,000 for the year for this customer service, for this Secret Shopper program. So this is kind of what we've seen in looking at our revenue. So what we've seen is about a 47,000% increase in revenue since we started doing this program. And that's compared from July through December of this past year, when you compare that to the previous year when we did not do the Secret Shopper program. So that's an 8% increase. And so you might say 8%, you were probably going to see growth anyway. So that's fairly true. So what we saw is for the first half of 2018, before we started doing the Secret Shopper program, we were at about a 3.6% growth. So we were growing at about 3.6% growth over the previous year. Since the Secret Shopping started and since we made that public to our staff, since July of 2018 through December, that increase has jumped to 8%. So we've doubled the percentage of our increase year over year. So if we continue this trajectory, just if you wanted, you know, of course, there's not a direct correlation here, and we're not saying that. There's lots of factors that are in here, but it's good to see that when you see that a new program has started like Secret Shopper, and you see the revenue increase like this. So over time, we're hoping to see about $100,000 increase over the previous year. So.
Thank you.
You want to take this one?
Sure. And this is our resident satisfaction with our community center. So it's about where we were last year at 44%. Our overall goal is 50%, which is always a hard goal because we know that not a lot of the population actually visits our community center. So this is where our marketing and telling our story and our communications come in. And investing more in telling people about what we do so that even when you don't visit our facility, our residents have a positive image of what it is that we do at our community centers.
This brings it up. I think I bring this up every time you guys come over. I still like the idea of what Chicago does, where they make the parks free for a month.
Mm-hmm.
I think they do April.
Mm-hmm.
Just encouraging people to get out and use the parks and use the park facilities. I still think that would be a way to drive up that resident satisfaction score if we would just, and they put signs up and market it, and it's you can't drive down Lakeshore Drive without seeing the signs about parks, or come visit the parks. And I think we ought to do something like that here. Just pick a month where we could just celebrate our parks and do something where that would make some sense.
So when did we start charging for our parks?
Well.
You mean the community centers?
Community centers, the whole concept of it. Make the parks, but just encourage people to visit their parks and then make the programs free in the community centers for that month. And that
don't give them any ideas.
We charge just if you drive by. Have you not been paying?
Send you a bill.
They said that they wouldn't take my money. I don't know why.
We do something similar to that. We call it, we've called it Discover Day in the past. We call it Play Day now. It's usually a day, or we've even done it a week. We play with it a couple of times to see what's the best fit. Sometimes it's a weekend where we offer all of our programs for free. You can come and skate at Lion Creek or take a fitness class. And we put our annual pass on sale, which is when we actually get a lot of new customers and renewal. So it's something we keep playing with every year, trying to figure out what's the best fit. If it needs to be longer, we could always look at that.
Do you think people understand that play day means free?
I hope so when we market it, but
you do.
You could always make sure it could always be.
You could just say free.
Free.
I mean, there's no ambiguity there.
You're right, Mayor. Thank you.
Or even free play day.
Free play day.
Or play today for free.
Okay. I'll talk to the marketing team about that.
Free probably ought to be in the title somewhere. I don't know. That seems to always attract people, that word free.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Thanks.
Roosevelt, we didn't have any particular data.
They won't return your call because they'll think it's some sort of a prank call.
That's true.
Too good to be true. We didn't talk about employee. We don't have data on that for this stat, but you want to speak a little to employee passes and just as a reminder to city employees, the benefit that we have?
Yes. So city employees right now, all city employees are eligible for a pass that's greatly reduced. So our normal annual pass is $300. And it is good at all 10 of our community centers. You can go swimming, you can go ice skating. For our employees, that price is knocked down to $120. And we do payroll deduction. So they'll take out, I believe it's 10 payments, 10 or 12 payments of $10 out of your paycheck. So it's an easy way. We actually just expanded that to family members. So you can add a family member to your account for the same price. So what would normally be a $600 value is only a $240 value now. And again, good at all 10 of our community centers.
Thanks. All right, strategy B is focusing on partnerships.
Yeah, so we have this new strategy in here. So one of the things we talk a lot about at Parks and Recreation, again, we're not the only department, I'm sure, that sees this. We partner a lot with organizations and neighborhoods for different events, different programs. And what we wanted to do is try to find a way to capture, how to capture and quantify what it is we do on a daily basis. When we partner with a neighborhood association to have an event at a park, that oftentimes we don't capture that as something that we do, but we wanted to make sure that we tell that story as well. So over this next year, we're really going to be trying to figure out what's the best way to capture that, but also to see, again, we get a lot of people that come to us and say, hey, you guys, we want to do whatever this event. And oftentimes it takes resources, whether that's staff time, whether that's actual monetary resources. We also want to make sure we have a way to vet those proposals and make sure they align with our mission so that we're all going in the same direction. So that's what this strategy is about. So over the next year, we'll be trying to get a baseline of our current partners, try to quantify whenever we like to say the return on investment, whenever we do partner with an organization or we get a proposal to partner with an organization, we want to quantify how much we're expending and what we're getting in return. And that return may not be monetarily, it could be a lot of things, but we want to be able to quantify that and be able to clearly express that so that we know we're getting into a partnership for the right reason. And then develop a model so every time somebody comes to us and says, hey, we want to partner with you, we can say, hey, this aligns with our mission, this doesn't, I'm sorry, we can do this, we can do that. Ideally, we get to a place where we're actually being more proactive about who we partner with and going out there and find those partners and not waiting for them just to come to us. So. I mean, this is an example of trying to be more purposeful and proactive about our partnerships. So we've done a lot of work. We've hired an inclusion coordinator, and we've done a lot of work on making sure our department and our programs are more inclusive. So right now we work with Ability KC, which is a therapeutic preschool. My daughter actually went to Ability KC. We love
that. Explain that, therapeutic preschool.
So it's a preschool for kids with or without disabilities. Uh-huh. So kids with either intellectual disabilities or physical disabilities. Also for kids without disabilities. So they again, inclusion. It's a great, I can't speak enough about it. My daughter went there when we were looking for preschools for her.
It's just a fee-bearing school.
Say it again?
Fee-bearing.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And they do accept
all comers?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Is it full day, year-round?
They do full day and half day, and they do year-round, yes, okay. Sir.
Where's it located?
Right up here on 31st and Main Street. So, and it used to be Children's TLC.
Okay, okay.
So it's in the campus with YMCA and the Center for the Visually Impaired. So,
yeah, okay, I know where you're at.
Yeah, great facility, great work over there. So we've been partnering with them to offer swim lessons. Again, my daughter took swim lessons there. They have a higher staff ratio. to make sure each kid gets one-on-one attention.
Yeah.
When we first started with them, they were the lessons were fairly high, so they were around $235, $225, which can be cost prohibitive for a lot of our families. So by partnering with them, we actually are able to lower that price to $30 a class, so people are much more able to afford that. And we do that by sharing some of that cost. We take on some of that cost. Again, swim lessons are something we've been offering for free for everybody, so we feel like even kids with or without disabilities should be able to take advantage of that. We just signed an MOU with a whole person back on January 26th to do some adaptive and inclusive programming. We have a fishing derby coming up, a fishing and archery derby. We do some archery lessons. We'll do some kickball with them. We just actually have purchased some chairs, 10 they call power chairs. These are chairs that you can use to play basketball or soccer. We should get those delivered sometime this spring, I believe, in April. So these, again, the idea is to include people. So whether you have a disability or not, if you want to play wheelchair basketball, you can come hop in a chair, whether you have one or not. We'll have those on site as well. And then we have our Special Olympics team. This is our second year doing basketball. They practice at Garrison on Thursday nights. We just took third place in the division, and we go to regionals on the 28th, so in Sedalia, Missouri. So they're actually pretty good. And these next few slides are going to talk a little bit about some steps we're taking with a couple of our centers, so specialty centers. So one of the problems that we tend to have with our facilities is they're very close together. They're located fairly close together, and when you have that closeness, it makes it really hard to differentiate them. So we really wanted to have a couple of centers that had their own identity. So Brush Creek Community Center is one of those. It's really close to Southeast, so we wanted to try to give it its own identity. And one of the things that we've always been successful at over there is programs for older adults. So we decided to make this facility our kind of hub for programming for older adults.
Why are you looking at me?
Talk to me after this. I got some good programming for you.
I got a program for you, too. You know, are you running for something? You've been talking a long time.
I'm sorry. I got a lot of good stuff to say. So we're partnering with a nonprofit that focuses on arts and aging programming. By partnering with this program, we can actually offer it to a nonprofit. They do some fundraising to help supplement some of the programming. We actually save money by not hiring full-time program staff. So we should save about $50,000, which is about 12 or 13%, while still delivering high-quality, consistent programming for older adults.
What's the popular programming there for older adults? I mean, is there something that they really gravitate to? And I say they because I'm not yet of that ilk.
Yeah, you wouldn't know yet. I don't know if there's anything popular. It really is just about socializing. So it could be anything. We do a lot of field trips where we take them to Starlight. If you don't know, a lot of them like to gamble sometimes. So sometimes they want to go into the casino. We take them to shows. So dinner and a movie is a good thing. So we've done some stage plays and dinner, so that's a popular thing.
That's good.
But a lot of times it's just about getting them all together. Sometimes we do a lot of feeding on site, so having food on site, sometimes bridge, you know, giving us something to do. It really isn't, I would say, so much about the activity that you're doing as much as it is about the atmosphere
getting
that you're creating.
There. Okay, cool.
And the arts, yeah. Painting, yeah. Arts and painting, we've done some, also some drama, some acting, but arts and painting and kind of the performance arts are huge right now for that
cool.
age group. Yeah,
outstanding. We're talking about partnerships and things of that nature. Have you worked out some deals like with the Nelson and those types of things to do some programs specifically aimed at that age group?
Yeah, Nelson's been a great partner with us, where they've come and actually provided staffing and done I want to say 6 to 8 week program with our seniors, and then taking them over to the Nelson and done some programming over there. They've been to the Kaufman and actually have done performances over there. So we do try to reach out to those partners, and that's kind of our goal going forward, is to really rely heavily on those partnerships to bring in that programming. They're already doing it. So instead of paying our full-time staff to reinvent the wheel, bringing those programs in and taking and going to those facilities as well.
Just a heads up, I think the Nelson's 30 Americans exhibit starts in June.
Okay.
And it's pretty powerful. I think it would play extremely well. It's 30 basically forgotten or excluded black artists.
Nice.
Around the country who have produced some tremendous works, Nick Cave and Ken Day and others like that. It seems like it'd be exactly what they'd like
sure.
to see. Very culturally relevant. as well as pretty good art.
I'm sure we'll check that out. Thanks. Thanks for that suggestion.
Keep rolling, Roosevelt.
Keep rolling.
Yeah,
our next facility, sorry, I'm winding it up. Westport Roanoke, so we're turning this into a an arts center, so an arts-focused center. Again, arts programming, there's a stage there. There's a pottery studio. So our goal there is, again, work with some of our partners to provide consistent arts, either performing arts or kind of fat, whatever the I'm not an artist, so I'll leave that to the professionals. So we're currently looking for a supervisor of recreation there with some art experience. So our goal there is to provide arts-focused programs through our after-school programming, summer camps, and all the other activities. Again, we do think we're going to save quite a bit of money there. So we're looking at about $100,000 or 20% of that facility's budget by working with those partners.
Cool.
It's a great idea.
Yeah, I know an 8-year-old who's super pumped. All right, moving on to objective 3, reduce blight, strategy A, creating a holistic plan for reducing blight in targeted areas. So I will turn this over to our capable staff from Neighborhoods and Housing.
Good morning. I am Delina Taylor, and I am with Neighborhood and Housing, Neighborhood Preservation Division.
Yeah, is your mic on?
Yes.
Okay. Not picking up.
Can you
up.
Not hear me?
Well, I can hear you, but I don't think your mic's picking up very well.
Okay. Is that better?
Not really, but. There.
It's not. Thank
yeah,
you.
Yeah, yours isn't on.
It isn't on.
Take his. He's not using it.
Okay.
There
All
you
right.
Go.
There we go.
There you go.
All right.
Much better.
Okay, so the first strategy is to inform landlords and educating them of just some of the processes for neighborhoods, some of the processes for understanding what we do and why they may be in violation. But we are right now waiting for grant funding from the federal government to start this program. So we're just kind of in the implementation process on that.
How long have you been waiting for funding?
That would be a Deletta Dean question, our answer.
Good morning, Deletta Dean, Deputy Director, Neighborhoods and Housing Services. We have been waiting on funding since August. This funding will come from the Department of Justice, Justice Assistance Grant. We will use a portion of that to implement the Landlord University, which is also a part of the housing policy. We will, as Delina said, we will educate landlords on the city's ordinances, both nuisance violations, property code violations, and then trash code violations. We will educate them on some tenant landlords, so we'll partner with human relations to do that. And then just bring them in and let them also know about city resources as a way to ultimately reduce set outs in the right-of-way. Hopefully reduce evictions along the way and just make the areas and neighborhoods cleaner. That's the goal.
And is this a renewal of an existing funding stream or a new funding?
This is a renewal of an existing funding stream that we're reallocating because we're just seeing this need grow greater and greater as evictions are higher. With solid waste being in the department several years now, we're just seeing more ways to partner and just really have a more holistic approach to addressing neighborhoods' needs.
Deletta, do me a favor, and we probably ought to bring Nasser into that conversation with the rental housing program now in effect. And if we've got the landlords as a captive audience while we're doing the education, it might not be a bad idea to talk about the rules and what we're seeing as we start at that rental inspection program.
Yes, sir, we absolutely will.
And if you're talking about evictions, that I would make that really one of the major focuses to some extent to try to find ways to reduce that number.
We will.
Again.
We will.
Thank you. Thank you.
One of the other issues that or concerns that came out of the housing policy was the idea of allowing redevelopers and investors in the city an opportunity to bring houses up to code without getting penalties for them. There were several people that came in and met with the city manager to voice concerns about fines and assessments when they start, when they acquire properties. So city staff collaborated and created a policy that would address those issues. The ordinance that came about was 180726. It is the Safe Harbor Initiative. And that program is simply going to allow a temporary stay of code enforcement on property maintenance violations. And we will just work with the newly acquired owners to get the properties up to code, giving them as much time as they need as long as we see continual progress. The ordinance itself outlines the process. Basically, the new owner will be allowed 30 days to come into the Safe Harbor program, request it, and we will only allow them to have a stay on Chapter 40, or I'm sorry, 56 violations, and that's the property maintenance violations. They will have to make sure that all nuisance violations are abated. This will also exclude any dangerous buildings that are in, you know, up, you know, they have to bring those up to code as well. It's pretty much the issue there. The new property owner will have to have an approved rehab plan, and they have to demonstrate ongoing progress in the project. We are working right now. We met with city planning on February the 1st, and we're working right now to get them get this whole process built into Compass KC. So we're working through that, and our goal is to have this out to the public by April 1st, which is just ahead of the spring rehab rush that we generally get this time of year.
Okay.
Good.
This slide indicates our reinspection cycle, and this is an ongoing slide that we keep in here because we know that getting back out to the properties within an ample amount of time really will help in compliance. So we do see a slight increase here in our reinspection time, but that is in large part because of the number of inspectors that I'm down. We have a class that's starting on the 19th of February, so we should start seeing this number decrease.
What's your current vacancy count?
10.
10?
Mm-hmm. A class will be starting with 5.
So you'll still run 5
out. We'll still run 5 short.
Keep trying to fill them.
Mm-hmm.
All right, Land Bank.
Good morning. I'm Michael Patello. I'm acting director for the Land Bank. And as you can see from the first slide, we are continuing to sell more properties than we're bringing in these days, which is the complete opposite of when we first started. So the trend is positive and it's upward. We are at the expectation is we're receiving approximately 101 properties coming in. We should get those in April or May from this last August county tax sale.
And that's vacant properties and structured properties?
That's total properties. And
so that's down significantly.
Significantly, right. And it's a combination of different factors. Less properties are being foreclosed on by the county. I think the public is being more educated and just being better stewards of their properties. More people are educated, and partly due to our program, that they're more educated towards vacant houses and properties and getting them before they even come to us. So they're buying more off the courthouse stairs as well. From what I understand, talking to some people at the county, it was almost a feeding frenzy over some of these properties where they were selling for a lot more than what was owed.
Hmm.
So they're getting them before they come to Land Bank, but you know, we still receive ours every year. We're gonna get some. That's one thing we can count on. This year we're receiving about 101 properties. If form holds true, it's usually about 4 to 1 houses to vacant lots. And so we're expecting 20 to 25 houses
and what condition those are in, you know, we'll
go on our demolition list.
they may go straight to demo, or some of them. So we may end up with 10 or 15 that are actually sellable.
So, land bank inventory at right now, we have about 84 houses that are sellable houses that we did not put on the demo list. You know, that's from 2014, I think we had over 500. So the trend is, you know, people are being more educated to the program. They know where to come for the programs. We are a component for first-time homeowners, or just, you know, people wanting to move into the city, as well as investors. So vacant lots, we have 2,710.
Investors. Considering all the problems we've had with LLCs in the past, are we doing something on the front end to try to avoid having that same problem going forward?
We like, vet our investors pretty good.
Okay.
We do background checks. Okay. We make sure that we check the properties that they already own to see if they're good stewards of the properties that they already own, if they're paying their taxes, if they've used the tax sale as a previous dump for properties that they don't want or don't or aren't taken care of. So we're making sure they're paying their taxes. We work with neighborhood preservation to, you know, make sure that, you know, they are code violation free, or they're working on whatever issues there are that are open. So and, you know, we scrutinize, you know, who they are, what their history is, where they're located. We highly favor local entities, and local means metro area. You know, the companies out of Australia and California and things like that are, they don't normally get properties through us. Whether they're sending in straw buyers or something like that, that's a whole different story. So there's always a game that's being played, and we try to stay, you know, step ahead of that. Like I said, we have a lot of vacant lots, 2,710. We have properties. We have agreements with different organizations where we put these on option agreements to give them time to get their development plans like neighborhood groups and things like organizations such as that, not-for-profits, who want to do something for the community as far as developing housing or making a park or just redeveloping in their neighborhood. We can't hold them forever, but we give them that opportunity to do something with it, and hopefully they can get some things done, get their plan, get their funding in order, work on designs, work on getting enough market interest to buy the houses once those houses are built. Land bank revenue and investment. In the last year, the revenue from sales, we've sold $404,181. That's the cash portion of the offer for the sales. We've had promised investments of over $9 million. We donate properties to different departments as far as like water or public works for different projects. And last year we didn't have as many requests. We did have some the previous year. We had several. So I think water department cleared us out of all the desired properties that they want, and any projects that Public Works has coming up, we're always willing to help facilitate those projects. next slide. We sell our houses with a deed of trust that keeps our finger in the pie when we sell a property, and whether that's a house or a vacant lot. So the deeds of trust last for approximately 3 years, and basically what that means, if the buyers aren't doing what they say they're going to do, then we have the right and the power to foreclose on that deed of trust. We are working on a lot of compliance things now, as you'll see from the upcoming slides. deed of trust, it contains the buyer's promise to rehab the properties, pay the taxes, and keep the nuisance up. It's not a monetary deed of trust like a bank would issue. A lot of title companies get that mixed up with what a bank would issue and want value and things like that. So our council has, you know, put in the value of their deed of trust as for what they promised to increase the property value, or not property value, but the investment into that property as. So if a person has a scope of work and they say they're going to invest $30,000 into that, then, you know, we're not holding them exactly to that $30,000, but it's a monetary value that we put into the certificate of value when those houses are transferred to keep the values up. We're trying not to further bring down property values in neighborhoods. So we want to keep those values up and keep a marker. So program updates, the dollar homes, and that's also in compliance that we're not doing that anymore. We just don't have the inventory. We work with Veterans Community Project. We're continuously working on some kind of financing streams and networking with different organizations and different banks and trying to get, people and organizations financed to do rehab loans and things like that. Code for KC is a software program that we're being used in force with, and Michael will talk more about that. We worked with different organizations such as NACCC. We're in the process of doing tax foreclosure reform. We're working with the county on a mutually beneficial program to help clear titles on some choice, not choice, but within a certain range. And it's almost a pilot. It's a pilot program that we're working on to see if we can get some of these titles cleaned up before they come into the land bank. So the county is our partner in that, and we're still working up all the details, and the city has a role, and the county has a role, and it looks like we're near the agreement, and that should be implemented in the next tax sale.
Michael, with that tax sale, you said about 100 properties coming, or we're expecting 100 in September.
Yeah, 100 properties that are on the court administrator's deed, or will be. Now, what gets claimed, we don't know until the last minute. We have to give the court their opportunity to do their process, so if 5 get claimed, then we'll get 5 less.
Yeah, any chance of doing another, whether it's $1 or $1,000, type program with some of those properties?
Probably not. Those programs were, we just had an overflow of inventory, and in order to divest ourselves of inventory, especially some of the worst, the dollar program was geared to some of the worst inventory that we had. And that was the last ditch effort in order to save those from demolition. And if an individual can do those properties versus the city paying for the demo, let's try it.
Absolutely.
And it was, we're still seeing the results. And those were hard rehabs. They weren't easy. And we realize that, and it's going to, it's taking time. We are working on compliance issues with not just those, but all the properties that we sell, just to make sure that people are doing what they say they're going to do.
Yeah.
though. Compliance, we have 590 properties that were inspected by land bank inspectors. Many had multiple inspections on them, and that's either drive-by or walkthroughs. We make appointments to walk into the house and to see where people are with the rehab. 366 of those properties been marked satisfactory or near completion. 55 non-compliance letters have been sent out to date. 30 days is given to respond back with the needed documents and a revamped rehab schedule. So we want to give people the opportunity to do what they said they're going to do. This is kind of just knocking on the door because we don't want to go to court and we don't want them back. But if they can't get them done, then let's get them in the hands of somebody who can. Out of those 55 letters, we've had 8 who sent back the requested documents. After time expired, then that's when our city attorneys take over and start the process for foreclosure. As to date, we have 7 notice of acceleration letters that are sent by the law department, 30 days, and that notifies owner of the breach of the deed of trust and the intent and failure to cure that breach within the 30 days, then we'll probably see him in court. So it's putting them on notice, putting it on paper, and letting them know that the process has begun. Go ahead. And this is just an example of a young lady who came into my office, and she was looking for a home. She didn't really see anything that she wanted. She was originally targeting the west side. And she didn't see any homes. We didn't have a lot of homes, and I kind of opened her mind to maybe doing some new construction. And she was looking for new construction places on the west side because she had in her mind the west side was going to be where she was going to land. And I gave her a few addresses, and I talked her into looking on the east side. And this home is at 20th and Agnes. Actually, it was on 3 lots that we had, and she went by and she checked out the neighborhood, which is the Washington Wheatley neighborhood, and she started exploring different ideas, and we kind of went through this journey together as far as what can she do as far as new construction, and this is actually a manufactured home where the home is delivered in pieces, so they build the foundation, the company builds the foundation and does all the plumbing and everything. And actually they did all the lot prep and everything. And we had City Communications, John Bacallo come out and we all, documented the arrival of the pieces of the house in the rain. And it wasn't a real good day, but she was happy. And it was kind of a milestone for the neighborhood where, we have all these vacant lots, and this is just one example of what can be done on these vacant lots. And so this is the manufactured home. They brought the back end and set it up, and then they brought, and within 30 days, the house we were working on the inside. And I think maybe 30 days later, she's in there. So, and she was an apartment, she was renting an apartment in Overland Park. I think she was paying like $1,300-$1,400 a month for a 1-bedroom apartment. Now she owns her home.
I mean, there's expensive apartments in Overland Park.
Oh, yeah, to say, yeah.
Those are cheap.
And now she's a homeowner who pays less than what she was paying in rent for her own home.
That's good.
So,
and there are 2,000 more vacant lots where this can also be done.
Absolutely. All right. Absolutely. So there's a hope, right?
Yeah, exactly. All right, Forrest?
Yeah, Forrest. Is this working now? Forrest Decker with Solid Waste. So one of the things we assist Land Bank with is the maintenance of these land bank lots and vacant properties. So we do this by mowing them and picking up the litter and, you know, taking care of any illegal dumping or hazardous trees or down trees, as we probably have a case of quite a few of right now. The mowing goes from April to October. It's primarily accomplished by the folks you see on this list, these neighborhood-based contractors. There are a few not-for-profit groups on there as well, but most of them are neighborhood groups that we deal directly, usually with the president of the neighborhood, to try to build some capacity and get some, you know, some of the dollars going back into those neighborhoods. What you see on the left there, the contracted services count, that is in addition to the mowing that the neighborhoods do. Those are work orders actually reported by the neighborhoods that we take care of with in-house staff in solid waste. So a lot of trash and stuff like that.
Cool. All right. Strategy B, dangerous buildings. I should note that this particular strategy in the plan we've marked as complete because it was dealing with the 2016 inventory that was addressed by the $10 million bond. But we also have ongoing work to do in the area of dangerous buildings. So, Delina?
Absolutely. The $10 million bond allowed us to make a great impact in the neighborhoods by removing the dangerous structures. The pre-bond inventory got up to 891 properties. Those dangerous buildings were all that was in the inventory prior to April 30th of 2016. So we have completed that. The goal was to complete 90% of those within 3 years, and we were able to complete 100% of those in 2.5 years, or a little over 2 years, wasn't even 2.5 years. So we were able to then move on to the next group of DB, dangerous buildings, because of course, as we are completing the backlog, more are coming in every year. We receive approximately 150 per year. This slide is showing the this is the pre-bond totals, and then how we just continue to move downward. That pre-bond inventory was, as of this reporting, 1, but that is now 0 due to that hearing. The hearing on that case has expired, so now that case will move into demolition. So of the disposition of the $10 million bond, we demoed by the city 458 of those properties. And one of the things that I'd like to point out, I won't go through every piece of this, but one of the things I would like to point out is the demolitions by the owners, as well as the repairs by the owners. One of the things that we're finding in this group of demolitions and our aggressive approach is that a lot of times the owners will now come out of the woodwork and really step up, and it really helps us. Of course, we're excited about that because it's money that we don't have to spend.
I do think we ought to acknowledge the Kissick Group and others who came in and volunteered some pretty significant services for relatively free to the city.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yes, we certainly do that. We Jim Kissick, mm-hmm. who is now no longer with us, and then Industrial Wrecking, it was a total of approximately 60 properties that they donated. That saves us a significant amount of money, about $600,000. So now we're working through everything from June 1 of 2016 through through current. Our post-bond inventory is 444. And this slide tells us where we are in the process. We are approximately 43% complete on our current inventory, with 191 done in various stages. And this kind of just outlines for you those stages. And for the sake of time, I won't just read through all of that. But 253 we're working through as far as getting the remaining properties through the process. This slide gives an excellent visual of the impact of the bond money and how we have removed dangerous buildings from the inventory. Shows, no, you're fine.
Yeah, I would just speak to this one. This is mid-year data for the resident survey. Dissatisfaction remains high and satisfaction low on the city's effort to demolish vacant structures. I have some theories about it. We're going to watch this data to see if now that, as you saw on the previous map, we've got a huge reduction in the number of dangerous buildings standing. So I'm thinking that will eventually translate out. But I do think that maybe where they are remain, that there could be some issues with folks looking around their neighborhood compared to five streets over, and all the those have all been demoed or are being rehabbed or whatever. So we're just going to keep our eye on this because it is one of the lowest satisfaction levels across the survey. So,
yeah.
All right, strategy C.
So we have been identifying and updating existing ordinances to just kind of strengthen our enforcement power as well as compliance rates. We're finding that oftentimes citizens just don't understand what the ordinances are saying. And also there was a lot of discrepancy in our ordinances, since a lot of the things in city planning or in health or some of the other departments that we partner with, their processes changed, which would consequently change our processes. So ordinance, we work from chapter 27, 48, and 56, and we partner with city planning and health with a lot of our ordinances. So we had to go in and look at our ordinances and change the language that was conflicting. We had several meetings with our attorneys in the law department, and we worked through revising and correcting many of our ordinances. 312 ordinances were reviewed. We have a substantial change to 140 of them, and we had 21 ordinances that were eliminated due to either going over to the health department or they just don't exist any longer. The next steps will be to get a summary for the city council. I just would like to give them a summary of the changes before we go and make the presentation to you all and the council.
All right, objective four, promote a clean community. I'll roll through these slides pretty quickly. Again, mid-year data on satisfaction with cleanliness of city streets. It looks like it's trending down. We'll keep our eye on that one. Strategy A deals with illegal dumping. Force, Michael?
Yeah.
This is more satisfaction data. So it looks like here we're remaining about steady with satisfaction cleanup of illegal dumping sites. And we'll get into some geographic, or put a little geographic look at this once we have final year data.
Okay, so this slide just quickly talks about our 513 dump hotline. We just started this a few months back. Don't have a lot of data on it yet. We've actually written quite a few summons from tips received from 513 dump, but that process takes a while to actually get to court. So we've only had, I think, six go to court thus far, and we've had 100% success rate with it so far. So we'll see how we go as we go along with that. This slide just talks a little bit about comparisons between FY 17-18 and FY 18-19 to date, which is just May through December on that. As you can see, we're way up on our court notices. We're on pace to greatly exceed our tickets issued, our citations issued. Probably the biggest success, I guess I'll point out here, is our self-cleans, the very bottom number. You know, in 17-18, we had 185. What self-cleans are whenever we catch somebody dumping, we give them the opportunity to clean that big mess up themselves, so we don't have to send out some of our solid waste staff to do it. And in lieu of that, we usually let them go unless it's really bad, then sometimes we don't. But to date so far this year, we've had 360 of those. So those are, you know, those are cases that were resolved by the person cleaning up themselves. We didn't have to drag them into court. We didn't have to send staff out to clean it up. And hopefully they learned a little lesson in the process.
All right, strategy B, solid waste compliance.
Yeah, this 185 to 360 number is the same one I just talked about with the self-compliance. You know, part of the reason for that number going up so much is we increased our code officers that focus specifically on illegal dumping from 2 to 5. One of the things we're trying to focus on a little heavier this year is on landlords. Whenever they either evict people or, you know, remodeling their rental house or whatever it is and put that stuff all right out on the right of way. And it just sits there for a long time until somebody reports it. Well, we're trying to crack down on that quite a little bit. So the next time we have one of these meetings, I should have a little bit more specific numbers on what the landlord ratio is within that number.
All right, strategy C, speaking of landlords.
This is the LLC compliance. We were talking about, Mayor, you were talking about LLCs and them just being all over the place and not really being held accountable. And of course, the Senate bill that was enacted to get more information from the LLCs. We now, it's a requirement that they have a real person on the books for us to contact when they are, for any reason, on their properties. And it has become very helpful for us in preservation and contacting those folks to try to get compliance on their properties. When we started this program, there was zero compliance. All of the LLCs in the city clerk's office were just listed as an LLC. Now, as the program has progressed, we're continuing to see compliance higher and higher for those properties. The compliance rate now, it started out in the beginning stages at 47%, increased to 61%, almost a little bit about a year later, and now it is at 68%. So we're continuing to see compliance there, and it helps us along the way too. The law department, when we don't get compliance, we will have those properties sent over to the law department, and Emily Black in the law department is working through the process of filing with the circuit court. Preservation will send out warning letters. The warning letters go out, and we've had 396 of the 835 that are no longer in violation. 299, they have other violations, but they have registered, and they're in compliance with the city clerk's office and with that Senate bill. Of the non-compliant ones, those are sent to the law department, and the law department is working through those.
Okay, strategy D, recycling in city facilities. I think we have a Kayleen, if you want to, or Esther, if you want to speak to it, whomever.
I'm getting the nod from Kayleen, so right. I guess it's me. Yeah, so right now we have a recycling committee that's built up from people from a few different departments. Forrest and Michael Shaw are on there. Kayleen Garrels from OEQ is on there as well. And we're working on our recycling policy for city facilities. We've had a few different steps going on in it, but right now we're working with Kristen Danner to try to get some floor captains to serve as kind of our recycling ambassadors to help ensure that people are, you know, going along with what they should be doing. We're kind of working on figuring out how to do a waste audit. Forrest might be able to explain that a little better as far as the volume of recycling actually picked up. And we are working on a survey currently to push out to city employees to kind of get an idea of how many of them are actually recycling at home and at work, but also try to gauge what barriers they're encountering and if that's a factor and if that's something that we really need to work on. So this policy will really reemphasize our commitment to the environment. We want to talk about the things that are recyclable with our single stream system, but also where to take those things that we can't just toss in a blue bin. So lots of information about household hazardous waste or some of our partners who take those hard to recycle items like electronics. And we want to strive for that waste diversion goal of 80%. One of the things we're having...
Question. Yes. It's not even so much the things that are hard to recycle, mm-hmm. glass being one.
Right.
Okay, glass is a pain in the rear. For people who like to drink beer in bottles, then it becomes a big pain in the rear. That's not me, but I've seen people.
Or the wine in bottles.
Or anything.
Yeah.
That
or comes the scotch.
Or yeah. scotch in bottles, yeah. All those things that some of us enjoy. That's
some of us.
We'll put that to the side. I understand the difficulties with that. But can't recycle brown paper, right? Can't recycle paper bags from grocery stores.
Yes.
All right, so what's the option here? Are we better off getting plastic? That doesn't work. We can't regulate plastic bags in grocery stores, but we can't recycle the brown ones. So is that because we don't have the, because of the cost effectiveness of trying to separate out brown from white paper? It seems like there's just too many things that you can't recycle, and it becomes inconvenient to bother trying to figure it out for people until you get into the habit. You're on.
All right. So the brown paper bags you can use for recycling. The plastic bags in the grocery stores, the big issue with that is hard to remove those from a single stream recycling system, and they gum up the machines and cause damage, downtime, so on. But to your point, there's obviously other methods. The issue with recycling is the resale market right now is struggling, and it's starting to rebound, but it's been under siege for some time. So what recyclers do essentially is if it doesn't make money, it don't make sense. And so then they want to change what your streams are, or, you know, they try to divert the streams to another way. We don't have much in the way of waste to energy, which are always other options to use in times like this. We don't have much of that type of option in this area as it relates to the curbside type materials. Very specifically to your question as it relates to grocery bags, we like to encourage to reuse bags, right? To take in the cloth bags and use reusable bags versus generating more waste, if you will, with more bags. So the recycling market is improving, but it's not where it used to be, but it is improving. So always the challenge is the sale of the material, and fiber is the one material which is hard to sell. But corrugated cardboard is good, plastics is good, metals is good, aluminums is good. Those things are great. It's that fiber which is the largest majority of what we recycle, certainly curbside, and actually even in the building, it's hard to move that product.
So the thing that's the largest waste product that we have is the one that we can't seem to get rid of.
It's a challenge to get rid of. It's a challenge to move.
Okay.
And I'll say to the point about trying to figure out what we can and can't recycle, a big part of this recycling policy will be coming out of the education and outreach green team. We will be working on just a piece that really talks about like what you can and can't recycle, where you can and can't recycle things, but also encouraging people to use those reusable bags or bottles or even, you know, beeswax wraps instead of saran wrap, and just talking about the other options. It's a real thing, I assure you.
Sounds like the dawning of the age of Aquarius again.
Maybe a little bit. But so it's really a big piece. It's requiring all the different green teams to work together, from acquiring bins for the common areas and City Hall and for the different offices to the education piece and then tracking you know, how much we're actually recycling as we go.
Okay. Yeah, I think one of the purposes of this strategy is part of the city's greenhouse gas emissions commitment for our own facilities, but also as a little proving ground for what kind of educational methods work for communicating about what can go into single stream and so forth that we could maybe then translate back out to how we educate our residents. But a little bit of get our own house in order before we try to move out. But, and obviously Michael and Forrest are doing a job trying to do that, but maybe we can learn something from how we communicate to our own employees. So.
Okay.
All right, strategy E. This is a new strategy on green space. I think Terry, you're gonna speak to this one.
Thank you, Terry Reinhardt, Parks and Recreation. So we all know that one of our biggest assets in this city is our green space, and we wanted to put this in to kind of help us track and be held accountable for how we are assessing the condition of those green spaces in terms of quality and accessibility in terms of any gaps that we may have in the system. So we did a study at the end of last year, at the end of 18, to talk about where we may be short on acreage. And what we really discovered is we've got a few gaps in the system, but more importantly, we have a tremendous, tremendous, tremendous backlog of deferred maintenance. We did an assessment in 17. The number at that time was about $30 million of deferred maintenance. So we did a condition assessment, and that really just talked about what needed to be done, whether that was crumbling stone walls or playgrounds that needed to be replaced, shelters, etc. So at that time we said, well, if it's more than $100,000, we'll consider that park in poor condition. 50 to 100 would be fair, and below 50 would be good. That methodology was flawed because the bigger the park was, the more amenities it had, the higher it scored. So parks that you would not anticipate would rate poorly did, because we were only using that dollar value. Since that time, we've gone back and revamped our SHAPE program, which is our Safe, Healthy, Attractive Park Environment. This is kind of our internal audit system on how we look at and do inspections on a monthly basis. And trying to come up with, we used to be on a pass-fail system, and we think we can get more value by rotating that to a percent of satisfaction or of passing on those individual amenities. So now we can actually say whether a facility is in good, fair, or poor condition based on something besides just the dollar value. So staff's worked really hard on bringing that SHAPE inspection up to speed and automating it. The other thing that we are automating is our regular park inspections, which are done by our field staff, and that's our switch to Cartograph, which I think we've talked about in a couple different sessions. So that gives us a pretty good idea of our physical conditions of our parks. We had a phone call earlier this week with Urban Land Institute out of DC and talked about, so what does that look like in terms of the quality of the experience and the quality of the value to the community? And that's pretty intriguing to us. I believe we're lobbying, and I think we will be one of their pilot cities to help set up some systems that would allow us to measure the quality of the park and the quality of the experience in the park with more data that comes from park users. I was trying really hard to talk as long as Roosevelt, but I'm gonna let him back in here
Takes
in a minute.
Practice.
But wait, it's not your turn yet. All that to say, we used to look at just, is a swing broke, does it need fixed? We think there's a lot more that determines the quality of a park and what happens in that park than just the physical amenities. Park maintenance cases, pretty steady. Of course, they peak in the summer. More people, more use, mowing complaints, and 311s. Our responsive time is going, getting better. The recent tree storm hit us pretty hard, but we'll we'll survive that. I am going to let Roosevelt talk a little bit about our IS. It hasn't changed tremendously in the last few years. And then our resident satisfaction and some key things we have in place.
excuse me. So our IS rating, something we talk about a lot. We actually talk a lot about this within our department. We use this data. I'm not just saying that because Julie's here or because she spends a lot of time in our department. So we actually take this pretty seriously. So as you can see, tree trimming and care is at the top of that list for importance and satisfaction. So it's not only important for our users, but the satisfaction isn't as high as it should be. So that's definitely where we spend a lot of time figuring out how to be a little more proactive on tree trimming and care. We do work with some partners to help us do that. Youth programs and activities. This one, you know, kind of affects my previous role as superintendent of recreation. So we've really been working over this last year to create a lot more youth programming, after school programming, adding quality to our summer camps. But also, we look forward to having a fairly large youth initiative with some youth sports programming. It's something that our department has worked with a lot of third-party organizations. When it comes to youth sports, we're looking forward to getting back into that business. We think that as a department, we can offer a very good alternative to some of the very competitive youth recreational sports that are out there at an affordable price, where kids are active and getting to play something without all the pressure that's kind of out there today. Those are two of the of our top things that we're working on over in our department, according to our IS rating. So got some work to do on those two. That's quick, wasn't it?
That was good. Good job.
And then, yeah, these are satisfaction levels. And Parks is, took early leadership on actually making goals out of these. And I think 70% was their goal for park maintenance. But you can move the goalposts now. So
exactly. And, you know, Roosevelt mentioned it a little bit earlier, but messaging is part of this issue. It seems that our user satisfaction surveys are much higher than our citizen sat numbers. And so we know that that's either don't know or haven't had the experience. And, you know, I think your 1 month of free activity is a good chance to try and do that. And then just continuing to tell that good story about all the positive experiences people are having, as opposed to maybe not getting that word out beyond our walls.
All right, strategy F. I'll throw this over to health.
Nasser Johari, Health Department, Environmental Health. Quick update on our air quality program. As you may remember, we still have an air quality program at the health department within the division. It's one of the programs that years ago we lost funding for through EPA and MDNR, Missouri Department of Natural Resources, and we are actually in the process of going back to update our current ordinance. Our current ordinance, it's some sections of the ordinance last updated were in 1967. So we are revisiting that, and we are also in the process of meeting. Actually, this week we will be meeting with the Missouri Department of Natural Resources to sign a new memorandum of agreement with the state. The other quick update I have is the noise complaints in the city.
Back on the air quality.
Yes.
The new agreement with the state, what's that get us? If they don't fund us, what does that what's the benefit of linking our air quality ordinances to state regs?
We are trying to kind of finalize some of the mandates that they have on localities in the state of Missouri. For smaller jurisdictions, they actually sign those MOAs by forcing locals to local municipalities to complete inspections for the state. The state charged per emission. And in throughout the state, actually, that money is collected by the state and inspections are done by localities. So trying to try to figure out some kind of an agreement. We know that the city of St. Louis managed to get an agreement where they get some funding to pay for their staffing to go and do these inspections at gas stations and other establishments that have air pollutants and emissions.
Okay, so right now under the current state law, we have the obligation to inspect and enforce, but all the revenues generated by the
that is correct.
State.
Oh, that is correct.
A deal for the state.
Yes. So we're trying to, same thing, if you remember a few years ago, we had the same thing with lodging,
yeah.
Inspecting lodging establishments, and we managed to get our own ordinance to charge for those. And actually, we got the support of the lodging establishments at that time. So we are trying to do the same thing here for those establishments to be inspected locally, and all their fees will go to their local, to the city. The other one is noise. We're still averaging around 400 noise complaints annually. I wanted to talk about two main things that we noticed throughout the last 3 years. We have, as an average, of 10% of our noise complaints, they come from trash trucks picking up trash after hours from mainly 1 a.m. until 5 a.m. And this is something, Michael, not in your shop. We were unable to regulate those. We tried to team up with the PD, but it's one of the big challenges. They are very common, repeat challenging, and they are becoming nuisance to those residents in those areas. I mean, I'm receiving 3 to 4 complaints on these trucks that picking up at a school or a shopping center down south next to an apartment complex. The other new trend that we started noticing some increased number of complaints, that Airbnb, some of these properties are turning into party houses. And for some, instead of renting a banquet hall for their banquet, they will just rent an Airbnb for $300 and have their party in the house. So this is a new trend. We started noticing some complaints. I know the majority of them go to PD. But we know that we started receiving some as the public are informed of our active noise ordinance.
I just wanted to piggyback on this, that the noise complaints, they actually alter their times and schedules so that they can keep us from being there when they normally do this. So there's some real challenges going on with those folks. And they've even been known to, if we try to block their vehicle to be able to give them a citation, the driver may get out with a gun or other things. So there's some real concerns on this. The other thing I wanted to mention on the air quality, it really impacts kids' asthma and attendance in school. And so it's a reason why negotiating this and getting some revenue so we can pick up our game on air quality is important.
And I was going to add that on the solid waste side, I've been involved in some of those discussions. What we're seeing also is a lot in downtown as we're building these condos and these business districts. How do we manage that? In the industry, we've been talking about trying to move some of those to a daytime collection. The problem is traffic. You can't get these big trash trucks into these nooks and crannies, if you will, during daytime because they're pretty large, to get into alleys and things of that sort. So as we continue to expand our condos and in these business districts or entertainment districts, if you will, it's going to become more of a challenge, and it's definitely something we need to think about how we manage that expectation.
Have we mapped, have we mapped our noise complaints? Are they primarily down? That's what I see mostly is
from
the downtown, midtown, where for years, separate Dr. Archer's issue about the attitude of the drivers, but most of the issues were downtown years was vacant after 5 o'clock at night, so nobody cared.
The ones that I don't know that I've seen all 30 or 40 or 50 of the complaints that they receive, but the ones that I get are typically the ones that are coming into downtown or the ones that are on like Valentine around like a business district that's next to a residential district. Those are the ones that I get mostly involved with, or we try to come up with solutions, especially on the consistent ones that keep coming in. But again, as we continue to expand this concept of you know, renovating buildings into condos, it's going to continually, we've got to just come up with a better solution, because, you know, it is almost impractical to pick up trash during the daytime in downtown. So it is going to have to be done at night. And so that becomes a situation.
We should probably look at our eastern neighbors, or like a Boston or a New York, because all of their trash collection is
done at night.
And so we probably ought to look at, and it's just part of life over there.
Actually, we do have a map for the data, and if you for the chart provided 2015-16, the difference, the spike in the number of actually noise complaints, they were because of that mixed use and all the development in the downtown area. In 2017, we went back and revised our noise ordinance to accommodate all these mixed use areas. So that's why there we have another drop in 2018, because of a lot of those complaints that we received in 2016 and 17, they're no longer considered as complaint based on updated new noise ordinance.
All right, that takes us to last objective in this stat. In objective one, increase overall life expectancy. We're running right around on time, but let's keep rolling.
Good morning. Tiffany Wilkinson, Division Manager for Communicable Disease Prevention at the Health Department. Just wanted to update you all on one aspect of the business plan that we're working on is dealing with some of our STDs. And nationally, what we've seen in the last, 2017, CDC has continued to see a huge increase in the number of reported sexually transmitted disease cases, 2.3 million. And it kind of goes along with a decrease in purchasing power for STD initiatives at the federal level, because they have decreased 40% of their funding for these STDs. And if you look, these are trends here locally on what we're seeing within our community. On the left, you'll see gonorrhea and chlamydia. Those continue to pose significant a number of cases within the Kansas City metro area and actually regionally. And what we're really focusing on right now is we continue to see a huge outbreak of syphilis that is occurring. And likewise, this is the first year in a few years that we're actually seeing increases in trends across all three of those diseases, but syphilis being our primary concern. Ideally, the risk groups we're continuing to see fairly similar over the past few years for syphilis. It started in men who have sex with other men, but it is now expanding beyond that to heterosexual individuals as well as pregnant women. And then youth are continuing to be the greatest number of our cases for most STDs, and that'd be 15 to 24 age group. The next slide, and why we're really kind of concerned with the pregnant women and it transmitting over to some of the pregnant women, is the potential for transmission of syphilis to the infant, whether that's even before, while they're still in the womb, or actually at birth. And this potentially can lead to death as well. And we unfortunately are aware of at least one stillborn case of a woman that was infected with syphilis. The reason that we're seeing kind of an increase in the number of cases is that many of these individuals, pregnant women, are not seeking prenatal care, and the importance of seeing that and being routinely examined by the obstetrician and gynecologist during their pregnancy. And so it's very important to get screened at routine intervals for these individuals, and we've been working very closely with the obstetrician and gynecologist throughout the city to make sure they're aware of the newest guidelines for getting those individuals tested and treated appropriately, because syphilis can be cured if it's caught early in the first and second secondary cases, but successfully cured, but you can be re-exposed if you continue to have exposure to someone with syphilis. Next, as I mentioned, we're really focusing in on, as part of our business plan, kind of wanting to be more proactive with STDs. With chlamydia in particular, not a lot is done nationally. They really don't do a lot just because of the other diseases that tend to take precedence or priority when they're peaking. However, we really wanted to focus in on that low-hanging fruit, which would be chlamydia cases, and identify those individuals that are being reported from the highest reporting facilities within the city, and make sure that those reporting hospitals or clinics work with us in assuring treatment. Because if we can assure treatment for these individuals, the chances of them developing other STDs or, in fact, HIV tends to decrease drastically. So our focus on the business plan was to identify the facilities to make sure we're getting these individuals treated. However, with the ongoing cases of syphilis and increases across the board in all STDs, we're finding that rather difficult. However, we're still moving forward and trying to focus in on this as well. Next on the strategy.
Before we move fully off that, if we can't get our hands around this, and it is becoming more and more of a challenge, the state had cut back on what they will process lab-wise. There, as mentioned, that we've been basically flat to reduce funding with increases of costs, and so we're actually not able to do the work we need to do to stop this outbreak. And it's getting very close to where I may be declaring a public health emergency on this very shortly. So I just wanted to make everybody aware this is not something we can ignore. And the fact that, you know, 8 babies are being born with this disease and one stillbirth is something that we shouldn't be tolerating as a city.
Thank you. And definitely, if it's not treated early, I mean, the consequences of not getting it treated, it can become a dormant phase and then really have detrimental effects later on in life as well. So next is strategy B. I just wanted to give you an update on kind of where we're at with our electronic health record system. We had forwarded a decision package to help us procure a new electronic health record system this year, and the need for that is extremely high. Our current system that we utilize is not cloud-based, and so it's very difficult for us to go out into the community and have access to our records and be able to screen and access records at that time. So I just wanted to, you know, it has been a slower process than we'd like. There's very complex issues involved with this. However, I am happy to report that we just finished with procurement the RFP rating of 7 vendors that applied for these. We had very good candidates. They're all very strong, and we've picked the top 4, and they're going to be coming in within the next few weeks. Actually, within the next month, we're going to be demonstrating, seeing the demonstrations of these 4 and then making our final selection and working with procurement to get the contract in place and make sure it contains everything that we need, hopefully, and we're still shooting for by the end of the fiscal year. So there's still a long road after that contract is in place. Then it involves configuring data from our existing system, moving that over, and actually getting the new system developed and trained, our staff trained and so forth, but we are definitely moving forward in this respect.
And this will obviously be critical of us tying to databases for outside providers so that we can more efficiently be doing contact tracing and follow-up and stopping outbreaks.
Definitely. Strategy C, we actually updated our code of ordinance last year, so that one we're happy to say is complete, and we're moving on to our next one. This is kind of expanding the city's surge capacity for major outbreaks. Last time, I gave you kind of an update on how we were looking at things with measles and foodborne illness outbreaks. This year, we've kind of taken a different approach and looking at specifically what's happening within our surge capacity for our syphilis outbreak that is ongoing. We're trying to deal with some changes. Sorry about the eye chart there. It's not meant to be red, but this kind of just showing how we're incorporating our public health preparedness strategies and best practices to actually implement preparedness planning and kind of efficient management of infectious disease and outbreak control utilizing the incident command system. This year when we were unable to fill, or we had to downgrade a couple positions for budgetary reasons that were supervisory levels, it impacted our ability to actually monitor some of our cases and make sure that we're actually seeking out all the partners and providing all the prevention and intervention activities that we need to identify during an ongoing outbreak. So on the next chart, or I'm sorry, on the next slide there, what we actually did was implement what we're calling our intra-divisional surge capacity to evaluate how we had to shift some things around internally within the division to make sure that we're focusing, again, kind of on the disease at large, in this case being syphilis. We implemented weekly meetings to with senior staff to basically review ongoing cases, look at what's being done, make sure the prevention and intervention activities are sufficient in order for us to make a kind of effectively impact this disease. This also included some of our senior staff becoming mentors to some of the existing disease investigators, so to speak, to help share best practices as far as interviewing techniques, making sure they're thinking of everything that they need to be asking those individuals, identifying all the partners, able to track them down, getting them screened and tested so that we can provide our intervention and prevention activities. And the last part of this is really making sure that we're publishing our data. We made a lot of efficiency improvements throughout the quality improvement throughout this process to make sure that we get that data back to the investigators to see what they're actually doing and be able to monitor their own progress as we're going through this outbreak. This is an actual performance measure that we continue to track quarterly. It's a percent of reported high priority investigations that we complete within 7 business days. Ideally, we really want it done within 3 business days, but we're still trying to get this within 7 business days. Our goal is 65%. You can see we started to see a downtrend in how we were able to function with HIV and syphilis cases in particular. So I just wanted to kind of highlight where we actually implemented our intradivisional surge and started tracking what we were doing with that to see what kind of progress that we could make. And you'll see on the next slide some of the metrics that we were monitoring around that. You'll see for the first quarter there, or it's actually the second calendar year quarter, that we were still not even really meeting our objective goal within 14 days. And so there was a lot of older cases that were open that we were really struggling to get submitted and reviewed by supervisors. And so implementing some of this additional staff and mentoring with our own staff was able to help. We started the surge at the end of August, so in the middle column there is towards the end, I guess, is when we really started to see an increase in our efforts. And you'll notice that the number of assigned and cases interviewed had gone up drastically, particularly between that second and third quarter, or it's actually the third and fourth quarter of the calendar year. We were assigning 11 staff to these efforts that would meet weekly, and we did calculate our additional staff hours that we were managing around this, and we were looking at, by the end of the year, within that four-month period, over 530 staff hours just from those individuals, as well as about $24,000 worth of additional staff time. Focusing on that. Again, these are management staff. It's not overtime. It's just additional things, efforts that we are making, which in turn results in us taking, efforts away from other things. Again, kind of reprioritizing some things. So lastly, the challenges and things that we are focusing on, I mentioned a little bit earlier when a person has an STD, particularly gonorrhea and chlamydia, their risk of acquiring HIV increases about by sixfold. So when we're taking away from some of our other investigative efforts, you'll see our decrease in interviews for gonorrhea and chlamydia decrease by 75% and about 59% respectively. The chances of potentially missing out on those counseling opportunities, providing the information and on, for example, post or pre-exposure prophylaxis for HIV or PrEP, things like that, that we have measures available and interventions available that can help prevent the further spread of HIV. But when our number of cases that we're able to actually interview, identify contacts, make sure they get appropriately treated, decreases by that significant amount, we potentially have a risk at getting additional HIV cases identified here in the city. So our funding streams, and like I mentioned with the federal level as well, we're still seeing the resources and funding not really fully supporting situations like this where we're having a significant outbreak and having to reassign or pull in mutual aid or do additional things in order for us to address these sufficiently.
There is federal legislation being proposed for another $70 million to CDC to help with this outbreak, because it's not just occurring here in Kansas City, but we are at a point where we are burning out our management staff that are working a lot of extra hours, and the problem then becomes that you can miss a meningitis or a Legionnaires or another type of outbreak because people are just barely coping.
Dr. Archer, if you were to, as you mentioned, declare a public health emergency over syphilis specifically, correct? What does that do to surge capacity for you? Do we have enough folks waiting in the wings to jump in?
It's hard to say because we're seeing this nationally and regionally. Everyone that's specifically trained to deal with these types of things, STD investigations requires quite a bit of specific training. We do have others like in smaller health departments that are trained as well, but they're likewise also dealing with their own cases. So it's something that we can probably get up and running fairly quickly and do some on-site quick training, but it does, the effectiveness of the interview is probably key, and making sure that you're trying to pull information out of somebody that may not be as forthcoming based on their risk preference or their risk behavior. So it's a very delicate kind of situation to where you have to build a rapport with that client and really to get the true information out, be able to provide those intervention and prevention steps. So
thank you.
Part of it is it raises awareness with the private sector that are seeing some of these cases, and if they're not getting those referrals to us ASAP, and if they're not preparing the folks that they're treating for knowing that we need to contact them to stop the spread, the number of people that can be infected if we don't see and stop the outbreak for 7 days after they're being treated versus three is significant. That pushing that up can help slow down an outbreak.
All right, strategy E, food code.
From STD communicable disease to food. we are in the process. We spoke last time and presented about updating our current ordinance, which is based on the 2005 FDA food code. The FDA finally released their 2017, which is the most recent food code they have, mid of 2018. So we started working on the revision process. Last Friday, we actually presented before the Mayor's Food Advisory Board. We got kind of their primary approval. They still wanted to take it to their stakeholders, Restaurant Association, Lodging Association, and Grocers Association. To get their feedback and buy-in into making those changes to our current food code. We're hoping to be able to present before committee and full council maybe sometimes around third quarter of this year. Part of our performance measures is to view the number of re-inspections that we conduct on our during our re-inspections. The measure reads as 75% of our inspections results did not result in a re-inspection. For the last 3 years, we've been averaging 74 to 73 average. That means 26 routine inspections resulted in a re-inspection. Food establishment, they were either unable to correct violation on site, or that violation we needed to go back and ensure that it's abated at the next visit. Also, for the number of closures and cease operation, we're still averaging as at 1.9 to 2% average closures, and mainly these closures or cease operations on these establishments because of the most common ones are temperatures and plumbing issues at these establishments.
All right, strategy F.
Integrated pest management and rat control. For the last few years, we've been noticing an average 20% increase in the number of rat control complaints. We've been going back to many properties over and over to provide that treatment. Usually when we receive a rat complaint, we have a contractor that will cost us $25 to go and provide treatment at that property. In 2017, when we started looking at our new Healthy Homes Ordinance, we realized that we provide a lot of these treatments to rental properties. So at that time, and after we implemented our new Healthy Homes Ordinance, we stopped providing those treatments to rental properties, and we started to put more pressure on landlords to treat their own properties. The projection, if we continued on that 20% trend, the projection was to do almost 3,000 treatment this year, or last year for 2018, and we dropped to close to 1,000 treatments. That's times $25, that's almost $50,000 to $60,000 worth of treatments that we've been providing on these rental properties. So far for the rat control, we're still active. We're still completing on-site treatments. Last year, we completed 235. Landlords performed rat treatments on their properties, 235. Previously, as I mentioned, all these landlords will call our office to request treatment, rat treatment on their properties. We received 998 rat complaints, and we treated 787 on owner-occupied. A quick follow-up on what we talked about previously. City manager suggested if we can start working on, or if we start working on pre-treatment for our sewer lines. We reached out to other jurisdictions, and the feedback we got that there is actually pre-treatment for sewer lines, the result is not significant, and it did not show any result as there's enough food for rats in the sewer system, so they're not gonna go after our bait. Yeah. So we paused on that, and we're trying to look for other options on treatments for our sewer lines.
All right, that moves us into the section that is on life expectancy. All right, we're going to cover this in two different ways. First, focusing on resident life expectancy. The following are a couple of slides, again, from a resident survey. We ask on that survey for folks to rate their level of health, how they would say their overall state of health is. This data is available on our resident survey dashboard, and you can kind of toggle through different demographic and socioeconomic profiles of individuals. And so you can see here, there's obviously some kind of correlation going on between income and self-ratings of health. Likewise, geographically, as we know that there are variations between zip code, our best geographic differentiation is on city council level. So the next slide shows the geographic difference in self-rating of health, which translates actually to actual health, as we'll see on the maps that are next. So I will turn it over to Dr. Archer and Frank.
Yeah, I have the
pleasure of introducing a new deputy for our health department, Frank Thompson. And it was probably 20 years ago when I recruited Frank. And the reason I wanted to mention this is that one of the things that brought his attention to me was that after he'd gotten his master's in public health, he'd actually initiated and started a charter school and ran it for 3 years. And I'm putting this plug in because one of the things that we had to drop out of the slide deck because of the number of slides was some of the issues around education. And I guess tonight, Mayor, over with the chamber from 6 to 7, there's going to be the pre-K meeting. And we know that if kids aren't reading on grade level, aren't graduating from high school, they're actually 17 and a half times as likely to die between 25 and 34 if you don't graduate from high school than if you go on to get some college and graduate from college. So these issues are really important. Frank?
Thank you. This next slide gives us two graphic representations of life expectancy by zip code across the city for 5-year periods. The big takeaway is the gap in life expectancy is increasing across the city. As you look at the highest or the lowest life expectancy zip codes, the big change there, 64109 has dropped out as one of those low life expectancy zip codes and has been replaced by 64129. There are a couple of things we're looking at as possible explanations for that. One is it's not that 64109 has gotten healthier in terms of residents' behavior, and 64129 has gotten more unhealthy. We're just starting to get into the data, but feel that it's an issue of population shifting, both within the city, whereas we do housing developments in one part of the city and raise what it costs to live in that part of the city, residents are forced to move to a different part of the city, as well as people moving into the city and where they are able to find housing. So housing policy is very much tied into this issue of life expectancy across the city. Next slide, looking at life expectancy over time, both for the U.S. and for the city. In the U.S., there's now a 3-year downward trend in terms of overall life expectancy for us as a city, starting in 2013, a downward trend, but the last 2 years we have leveled off somewhat in overall life expectancy. But there's still, next slide, there's still an issue in terms of equity across the city. And in terms of equity between our lowest and highest life expectancy zip codes, we've actually gotten worse. We've gone from 12.7 back in 2002 all the way up to 15.5 here in the latest period, 2013 to 2017. When we look at that, next slide, by race and gender, so the top line there shows the difference for between black males and white males. The bottom line shows the difference between black females and white females. So you see there for males, there's an ongoing increase in terms of the gap in life expectancy. The line for females pretty much level. Back in August when we presented on this, there was discussion around the role of homicides and those disparities, in particular the disparity between white males and black males. And we're continuing to try and dig into the data a little bit more on that.
Okay,
good.
Yep.
Can we go back? You said something about 17 and a half times less, more likely to die between the ages of 17 and 24 if you don't finish high school.
I may have said it that way to make it correct. If we look at a cohort of Kansas City, Missouri folks from age 25 through 34 for that 10-year period, if they didn't graduate from high school, they are 17 times as likely to die in that 10-year period than if they graduated from college. But even if they graduate from high school and don't go on for technical training or some college, they're still 12 times as likely to die in that 10-year period. So there's no question that education is a huge issue and risk factor for life expectancy and a lot of the other things that we're focusing on. So again, that's why the pre-K is so important.
Okay, thanks.
All right, looking at, or switching focus a little to employee LifeX, at the last LifeX Summit, again, we took our information that we had externally and sort of put the flashlight on ourselves. And so on our Elevate KC survey, we also ask our own employees the same question we asked the residents about how would you rate your overall state of health. You can see we did have an increase from 2016 to 2018, but our employees actually still lag our overall rating by our residents. That could be partly because 15, almost 16% of our city employees live in these lowest life expectancy zip codes, so we know we have a decent proportion of our staff that are dealing with the same determinants of health that are creating these life expectancy gaps. So at this summit, department directors, deputies, city staff got together, came up with a set of sort of big ideas for us to implement. The committee that's working on this that consists of Elizabeth and Frank from the health department and director of city planning and development, Jeff Williams, here is pictured leading the, a conversation. We've gotten together to look at some of these ideas, prioritize them, submit them to the city manager for future implementation. Great. Strategy I.
And for this, I'm going to introduce a member of my staff, one of our health department statisticians, Elizabeth Walsh, and she'll walk us through this information.
Hi, good morning. Our first step for this strategy and the following one is to simply establish a baseline of where we are at. So for infant mortality, we created risk zones, with the highest risk zones mirroring the LifeX zip codes, except for 64127. And the reason why we don't see 64127 in that high risk zone is because that's a largely Hispanic population in that zip code. And we just know research shows that the Hispanic community has very low rates of infant mortality in general. I was worried you're going to ask me that question, and then I didn't do any research on that. My hypothesis is that the Hispanic community is very connected, so there's a lot of social support, whereas what we see with these moms and these babies that have these high risks, they don't have a lot of that social support.
Yeah, and we see that nationally. It's not just in Kansas City that whether it's single parents or being more likely to be in stress from evictions and all those things really do matter. And so some of these differences that the Hispanic Latino population have, though, when they go several generations in this country, it starts to get worse again. So when they come in the first generation, they keep this social cohesion that then starts to get degraded over time.
Right, strategy J.
Okay. And again, this is we're just simply establishing a baseline for our potentially preventable hospitalizations. And just for those who aren't familiar with that term, these are hospitalizations that potentially could have been prevented had somebody sought care in a primary care setting versus waiting until they got so sick. So we just have here a selection of preventable hospitalization diagnoses that have the potential to be impacted through our work, through programs such as Healthy Homes or through work with our community partners, including the Health Levy funded safety net providers. And as you can see, there is a disproportionate number of preventable hospitalizations occurring in our low life expectancy zip codes, and this is contributing to a higher rate for the city overall, which is higher than the Missouri state rate.
This is also important for the hospitals because they can get penalized on Medicare and various other funders if they have return or repeat hospitalizations also. So it actually impacts them negatively, not only impacting, obviously, health of our population. We know that it's much better to treat something when it's a smaller problem. If you treat asthma more effectively and kids stay in school and as opposed to ending up in the emergency room or hospitalized.
Okay, Strategy K.
And for this next, these next two slides, we're going to introduce another member of my team, Erica Taylor, who is our new Health Commission liaison over at the Health Department, and she'll talk about our CHIP, Community Health Improvement Plan.
Hey, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Okay, here we go. I noticed your socks, Mayor, when I walked in, so I wanted to compliment you on those.
Thanks.
So we're familiar with our Community Health Improvement Plan, so just a few updates as we're going to, update it and amend the CHIP a little bit. So we know that we complete the CHIP every 4 to 5 years, and we want to ensure, this is probably the most crucial piece in my opinion, we want to make sure that those priority areas that are identified in the CHIP are coming from our community residents and not from us. And so we're, as we revitalize the CHIP, we're going to make sure that we do have that input from residents. We also are going to ensure that our data are updated through our dashboard, which is real easy to use, real user-friendly, so I can't wait for residents to see it and be able to use that. Next slide. So our timeline for updating, in March, we're going to kick off our revision process. In April to May, we'll update the resources that we want to make available to our community residents. June and July, we're going to host a series of community events to ensure that their input is included in the work that we do. August through September, our platforms will be updated, and then in October, we'll be ready to present it again and submit it to our mayor and city council. Thank you.
And just a couple of final points about our community health improvement plan. Just to really point out, although it's required in our charter and it's also required for us as a health department under our national accreditation, for us it's really more about creating common goals for stakeholders across the city. And our CHIP is really trend-setting in that we have gone beyond just a focus on individual disease categories to look at factors that inhibit health or influence health, things like violence, education, built environment. You don't find those in most city community health improvement plans. In fact, ours is probably the only CHIP in the country where the majority of the issues we include in our community health improvement plan are social determinants rather than specific disease or health categories.
I've lost track of where this may have ended up, and I'm not sure that it did or did not end up in the health department, but I know that at some point I was trying to find out whether or not we could have CDC come in here and investigate violence, particularly gun violence, as a disease factor as opposed to an anti-gun measure. Was that something that you guys were involved in, or was that NOVA?
That was, we've been working with CDC to try to get some resources. There is some progress now at the state level where certain data systems that weren't available in Missouri are starting to get into place, but we've gotten some funding, but CDC unfortunately has been partly muzzled over this whole thing, but now with the weakening of the NRA, there may be some new opportunities.
Well, yeah, but the reason I raised it initially was because I'd read, and I'm really shaky on my recollection, but I found out through some source or another the CDC itself had actually engaged in a study of a city and gun violence as a health issue, and I was wondering if they could do it in one place, they can do it in others. And I understand the restraints on them by a rather ignorant federal legislature, but be all of that as it may, their focus was really on the CDC being a deterrent to gun ownership, and I think CDC shifted it to a study of health impact, which might get around it. But I'm curious. I think that if we can find a way to get them engaged, that gives it a lot more heft, and it might be able to spur some change. Well, I was going to say some change at the state level, but I'm dreaming. But at least it gives us another weapon to fight with.
Yeah, I remember a meeting several years ago that you'd called that came up to your office, and we were talking about this exact issue, and we pursued it a couple times, and it didn't look at that point that there was anything. But as you know, these good ideas just have to be brought back every once in a while when the timing is right, and we will continue to pursue this.
Well, if the issue is the federal legislation, there's a chance that federal legislation could change in the next couple of years. We need to be ready for that.
Yeah.
So I don't know what sort of data needs to be evaluated or collected, but I think if the Congress changes and there's a different majority in the Senate and somebody different in the White House, praise the Lord. Sorry about that. No, I'm not. then there's a chance that something like that could be done.
The 30 big city health departments have been working together on this exact issue, and we've got the de Beaumont Foundation interested in helping to support the drafting of federal legislation similar to Ryan White for HIV, but for violence for cities for a public health approach. And you're absolutely correct. If the right unfortunate disaster occurs at the same time you've got the right support in the branches of government, we could move that forward. And there have been some early conversations with the U.S. Conference of Mayors along the same line, so we probably need to tighten that a little bit more and be, regardless of what you think, after 9/11, the Patriot Act wasn't written at that time. They already had it on the shelf and were ready to put it forward. And so if we don't have this kind of national legislation already ready when the time's there, we'll miss the opportunity.
Exactly right. Okay. Thanks.
Okay.
Thanks. And thank you, Eric.
You're welcome.
I've got other socks like this.
So many socks.
I've got a lot of things for Casey on them.
All right, that takes us to the end. Thank you, everyone, for your contributions.
Super. Thanks, guys and ladies, for the good effort. Roosevelt, good luck with your campaign.
I hear there's an opening.
No. Not yet.
Dave's too late, Roosevelt.
Not yet. You got to go and run with the other 13 people, whatever it is.
Thank you, Mayor.
Hey, I need to ask you a question.
Yes, sir.
Thanks, everybody. Keep up the good work.
I've got a guy.
Organized group like yours, please give them.